Welcome all my dear students. I hope all of you are doing fine, Alhamdulillah, and continue your study at home. Today I want to discuss some important topics with you from item 4 of cardiovascular physiology. Now let us proceed to the topics that we are going to study today. Now my first topic is cardiac output. Now the definition of cardiac output, it is the quantity of blood that is pumped out by each ventricle in each minute. As it is in each minute, it is also called the minute volume. The normal value are in a resting supineman, the average value is about 5 to 6 liters per minute. And please remember, it is 10 to 20% less in case of female. Cardiac output is one of the most important factor because at each beat, certain amount of blood is pumped out by each ventricle in each minute into the aorta that flows through the circulation and reaches to all the tissues of the body. Now let us revise our knowledge about circulation. What happens there? We know superior vena cava and inferior vena cava opens into the right atrium. Superior vena cava collects deoxygenated blood from the upper half of the body and inferior vena cava collects deoxygenated blood from the lower half of the body. So right atrium contains deoxygenated blood. From this right atrium, the blood goes to the right ventricle through tricuspid valve. And from the right ventricle, it goes to the pulmonary trunk through pulmonary valve, which is a semilunar valve. And from the pulmonary trunk, it goes to the lungs for oxygenation through pulmonary artery on both sides. In the lungs, deoxygenated blood is converted into oxygenated blood. From these lungs, this oxygenated blood comes into the left atrium through two pulmonary veins present on both sides of the lungs. Heart. So the left atrium contains the oxygenated blood. From the left atrium, this blood goes to the left ventricle through mitral or bicuspid valve. From the left ventricle, the oxygenated blood goes to the aorta through aortic valve and it is circulated throughout the body. This is our knowledge about circulation. So what is cardiac output? It is the amount of blood which is pumped out by each ventricle, right ventricle or left ventricle in each minute. This is the cardiac output. From left ventricle, blood goes to the pulmonary, blood goes to the aorta through aortic valve and is circulated the whole body. So it is clear, it is the quantity of value in a resting supineman. It averages 5 to 6 liters per minute, which is minute. The normal value is 10 to 20%. Equation of cardiac output. Cardiac output is equal to heart rate into stroke volume. We know heart rate is nothing, simply the number of heartbeats per minute. It means it is only the pumping ability of the heart in beats per minute, which is 72 beats per minute in resting adult. And the stroke volume is nothing but the volume of blood which is ejected by each ventricle by each beat, which is 70 ml per beat. An average person has a resting heart rate of 72 beats per minute and a resting stroke volume of 70 ml per beat, then the cardiac output for that person at rest is equal to heart rate into stroke volume, that is 72 beats per minute into 70 ml per beats, that is 5040 ml per minute. If we converted it into liter, it will be 5.04 liter per minute, which is averages 5 liters per minute. Now another important topic, this is always comes in the examination in short note, what is cardiac index? We know there is a correlation between resting cardiac output and body surface area. Cardiac index may be defined as the cardiac output per minute per square meter of body surface area. It means that cardiac output is directly proportional to the body surface area and weight of the body. An average human being who weighs 70 kilograms has a body surface area is about 1.7 square meters, which means that the normal average cardiac index for adult is about 3 liters per minute per square meter of body surface area. যখন কার্ডিয়াক ইন্ডেক্স বলবে তখন এই এককটা খুব সুন্দর করে বলতে হবে, 3 লিটার পার মিনিট পার স্কোয়ার মিটার অফ বডি সার্ফেস এরিয়া, পুরোটা কমপ্লিট করতে হবে। ইট ইজ ভেরি ইম্পর্টেন্ট হোয়াট আর দ্য নাও হোয়াট আর দ্য সিগনিফিকেন্স অর ইম্পর্টেন্স অফ কার্ডিয়াক ইন্ডেক্স। বাই কার্ডিয়াক ইন্ডেক্স উই ক্যান নো the cardiac output of different size of the people can be compared, the cardiac output of different age of the people can be compared, sorry, the declining cardiac index is indicative of declining activity or declining muscle mass with the age. It means cardiac index is 4 liter per minute per meter square of body surface area up to the age of 10 years and which decreases with the age, that is in 80 years it becomes 2.4 liter per minute per square meter of body surface area. In this picture we show cardiac index is rising rapidly to a level greater than 4 liter per minute per meter square of body surface area at the age of 10, and you see at the age of 80 it declines to 2.4 liter per minute per meter square of body surface area. It means cardiac index is decreasing with the age. At the young age it is more and at the old age it becomes less, which indicative of declining muscle mass. Now another important topic is cardiac reserve. It is also come in the examination as short note. Cardiac impulse, cardiac reserve, it is the maximum percentage that the cardiac output can increase above the normal is called cardiac reserve. In young healthy adult it is about 300 to 400%, in athlete it is 500 to 600% or more. Now I explain it. Cardiac reserve, it explains that it is the capacity of heart to generate sufficient energy for ejecting a large card. Normally the cardiac output is 5 liter per minute, but during exercise a healthy young adult can raise the cardiac output about 5 times than normal, which becomes about 25 liter per minute. If we converted it to the percentage it will be 400% increase. So according to Sir Starling's law, cardiac reserve is nothing but the physiological capacity of heart. It decreases in the myocardial disease or and valvular disease. It means any factor that prevent heart from pumping blood satisfactorily will decrease the cardiac reserve. In case of ischemic heart disease, vitamin deficiency which affect the cardiac muscle, or physical damage of the myocardium or myocardial or valvular disease, there is decreased cardiac index. In case of heart failure, there is no cardiac index. So cardiac reserve and cardiac index is very important for both viva and written examination. Now another important question, what are the factors that regulate cardiac output? There are 4 important factors that regulate cardiac output, that is venous return, force of myocardial contraction, peripheral resistance and heart rate. Venous return, what is it? It is the quantity of blood that flowing from the veins into the right atrium in each minute. It is equal to the cardiac output. Venous return is one of the primary mediators for the cardiac output. So venous return and cardiac output must be equal to one another. Anything that increases or diminishes the venous return will alter the cardiac output accordingly. Now the next is force of contraction, myocardial contraction. When the force of contraction of heart increases, stroke volume also increases. Therefore cardiac output also increases. As we know, cardiac output is equal to heart rate and stroke volume. So there is any change in the stroke volume, it will alter the force of myocardial contraction, will alter the cardiac output. Next term is peripheral resistance. It is the resistance against which heart pumps blood, is known as peripheral resistance. Heart always try to maintain a constant cardiac output and blood flow, even increased peripheral resistance. So if there is increased peripheral resistance, decreased venous return, it will ultimately decrease the cardiac output, heart rate. When heart rate increases, cardiac output also increases. As we know, cardiac output is equal to heart rate into stroke volume. Any factor which changes heart rate will also change the cardiac output. In this figure, we show cardiac output is the product of heart rate into stroke volume. Okay. Stroke volume again divided into myocardial fiber shortening or myocardial fiber contraction, which again depends on preload, reload, afterload, and contractility. Now, there are various effects or conditions on the cardiac output. What happens? When cardiac output, there is no change occur. No change of cardiac output occurs during sleep and moderate change in the environmental temperature. And cardiac output is increased in anxiety and excitement around 50 to 100% during eating, 30% during exercise up to 700%, high environmental temperature, pregnancy, and epinephrine. And cardiac output is decreased during sitting or standing from the lying position, which is about 20 to 30%, rapid arrhythmias, and heart disease. Please see here, during moderate change in the environmental temperature, there is no change in cardiac output. But during high environmental temperature, cardiac output is increased. Why? Because during high environmental temperature, there is increased heart rate, which increases cardiac output. And during pregnancy, there is hyperdynamic circulation, which increases the cardiac output. Now, the methods of measurement of cardiac output. This is a very commonly written question, commonly comes in the written examination. There are several methods for measurement of cardiac output. The methods are different in case of experimental animal and in human. In experimental animals, cardiac output can be measured with an electromagnetic or ultrasonic flow meter placed on the ascending aorta or pulmonary artery. So one can cannulate the aorta, pulmonary artery, or great veins and enter the heart of the experimental animal and measure the cardiac output by any flow meter. Now in human, there are several methods for measuring cardiac output. Number one is oxygen Fick method. It is also called only Fick method. Number two, indicator dilation method or thermodilation method. Number three, Doppler combined with echocardiography. Now, I will discuss about oxygen Fick method. Oxygen Fick principle. In 1870, Sir Adolf Eugen Fick described the Fick principle. So, the Fick principle states that the amount of a substance taken up by an organ or by the whole body per unit of time is equal to the arterial level of the substance minus venous level of the substance times blood flow. This is the Fick principle. Okay. The principle can be used to determine the cardiac output by measuring the amount of oxygen consumed by the body in a given period and dividing this value by arteriovenous difference across the lung. In this figure, hello? কিছু বলছো?
আমি ঠিক প্রিন্সিপলটা বুঝি নাই।
200 ml of oxygen are being absorbed from the lungs into the pulmonary blood continuously. Okay, from the lungs into the pulmonary blood, 200 ml per minute of oxygen is absorbed from 200 ml per minute. It also shows that right heart, that is blood entering into the right atrium, has an oxygen concentration of 160 ml per minute, and leaving the heart, that is in the left atrium, the oxygen concentration is 200 ml per minute. Okay, ami abar explain korteci Fick principle. Fick principle is one of the commonest method for using the cardiac output. Cardiac output, it is a principle. What is that principle? The Fick principle states that the amount of a substance taken up by an organ or by the whole body per unit time is equal to the arterial level of the substance minus venous level of the substance. I will explain this equation in the next slide. Clear. Okay. In this figure, this is the figure of Fick principle. This is the lungs, this is the heart. From the lungs, 200 ml of oxygen are being absorbed from the lungs into the pulmonary blood in each minute. It also shows that blood entering the right atrium has an oxygen concentration of 160 ml per liter of blood, where that the blood leaving in the left atrium has an oxygen concentration of 200 ml per liter of blood. Okay. Now the Fick principle, according to Fick principle, cardiac output, which is measured in liter per minute, equals oxygen consumption from the lungs, which is expressed in ml per minute, divided by arterial oxygen concentration minus venous oxygen concentration. Is it clear now?
Okay. Yes, ma'am.
By applying the Fick procedure, we can measure cardiac output in human. How? A mixture of a sample of mixed venous blood is obtained from the pulmonary artery by means of cardiac catheter. We know the blood entering the right atrium has a concentration of 160 ml per liter of blood. Now it has become a commonplace to insert a long cardiac catheter in the brachial vein of the forearm through subclavian vein, then it down to the right atrium, right ventricle, and small branches of pulmonary artery with the help of fluoroscope. I want to mean that how we collect the sample of venous blood. We can collect the venous blood by a cardiac catheter, which enter into the heart through subclavian brachial vein, through subclavian vein, then enter into the right atrium or right ventricle or small branches of pulmonary artery. From there, we can collect the venous blood. Now, how can we collect the systemic blood? The systemic arterial blood has same oxygen concentration in all parts of the body. We know it. So, a sample of arterial oxygen content can be obtained from any convenient systemic artery. Now, the total quantity of oxygen absorbed into the pulmonary blood from the lungs is about 200 milliliters per minute. It means that 200 ml of oxygen are being absorbed from the lungs into the pulmonary blood in each minute. It is measured by disappearance of oxygen from the respired air by using any type of oxygen meter. This oxygen is consumed by the whole body. So this is the procedure of collection of venous blood, venous sample of blood, arterial sample of blood, and oxygen concentration from the lungs. So according to Fick principle, cardiac output is equal to oxygen consumption divided by a arteriovenous difference, that is arterial concentration of oxygen and venous concentration of oxygen, which is expressed in ml per liter. So the cardiac output is equal to oxygen consumption from the lungs is 200 ml per minute, arterial oxygen concentration is 200 ml per minute minus venous oxygen concentration, which is 160 ml per minute, which is that is 200 divided by 40 ml, that is 5 liter per minute. This is the cardiac output. If there is any question, you can ask me. Any question about Fick principle?
ম্যাম আমার একটা প্রশ্ন ছিল।
হ্যাঁ বলো।
ম্যাম আমরা রেসপিরেটরিতে পড়ছিলাম 250 ml অক্সিজেন পার ইউনিট।
না এটা এটা তোমার ভ্যারি করে। গাইটন টু গ্যানন তুমি যদি 250 ml অক্সিজেন দাও, এখানে হচ্ছে তোমার এখানে 200 জায়গায় 250 ml হতে পারে। সেই ক্ষেত্রে তোমার কার্ডিয়াক আউটপুটের মানটা চেঞ্জ হয়ে যাবে। আমি প্রথমে বলেছিলাম কার্ডিয়াক আউটপুট ইজ ইকুয়াল টু 5 টু 6 লিটার পার মিনিট। ঠিক আছে?
থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাম।
হ্যাঁ এখানে এটা এটা 200 থেকে 250 পর্যন্ত হতে পারে। এটা গাইটন এবং গ্যানন একটু ভ্যারি করে। তো অ্যাজ গাইটন আওয়ার টেক্সট বুক আমি গাইটন থেকে এটা নিয়েছি। হ্যাঁ তুমি যদি এখানে 250 ডিভাইডেড বাই 40 দাও, সেখানে তোমার এই মানটা চেঞ্জ হয়ে যাবে। তা আমরা জানি রাফলি কার্ডিয়াক আউটপুট ইজ ইকুয়াল টু 5 টু 6 লিটার পার মিনিট। আর কে জানি আমাকে বলছিল যে তুমি প্রিন্সিপালটা বুঝো নাই, একটা মেয়ে বলছিল মনে হয়। এখন কি ক্লিয়ার হয়েছে?
Yes ma'am.
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে, তোমার কি কোয়েশ্চেন ছিল?
প্রিন্সিপালটা মানে বুঝি নাই তখন।
আচ্ছা তুমি প্রিন্সিপালটা বুঝো নাই, কারণ এই ইকুয়েশনটা না বুঝে তুমি প্রিন্সিপালটা বুঝবে না। ওখানে বলা হয়েছে যে তোমার দ্য টোটাল অ্যামাউন্ট অফ সাবস্টেন্স টেকেন আপ বাই অ্যান অর্গান বা অর বাই দ্য হোল বডি পার ইউনিট টাইম ইজ ইকুয়াল টু দ্য আর্টারিয়াল ভেনাস ডিফারেন্স টাইমস ব্লাড ফ্লো। দেখো দ্যাট ইজ কার্ডিয়াক আউটপুট, দ্য টেক হোল ব্লাড টেকেন আপ বাই দ্য অর্গান ইজ ইকুয়াল টু অক্সিজেন কনজাম্পশন ডিভাইডেড বাই আর্টারিও ভেনাস ডিফারেন্স। এটা কিন্তু রিটেন পরীক্ষায় খুবই একটা কমন কোয়েশ্চেন, ফ্রিকোয়েন্টলি আসতেই থাকে, হোয়াট আর দ্য মেজার্স অফ হোয়াট আর দ্য মেথডস অফ মেজারমেন্ট অফ কার্ডিয়াক আউটপুট। হ্যাঁ, পিক প্রিন্সিপাল অথবা অক্সিজেন পিক প্রিন্সিপাল ইজ দ্য সেম থিং। ঠিক আছে, আমি নেক্সট যাব ভেনাস রিটার্নে। হোয়াট ইজ ভেনাস রিটার্ন? বাই ডেফিনেশন ইট ইজ দ্য কোয়ান্টিটি অফ ব্লাড দ্যাট কামস ফ্রম দ্য পেরিফেরি টু দ্য রাইট অ্যাট্রিয়াম অফ দ্য হার্ট ইন ইচ মিনিট is called venous return. It is always remember that venous return must be equal with the cardiac output because venous return is one of the primary mediator for cardiac output as I mentioned earlier. So the amount of venous return is about 5 to 6 liters per minute. We know the deoxygenated blood is collected to the right atrium of the heart from the superior and inferior vena cava. This deoxygenated as we know cardiac output means it is the amount of blood which is pumped out by each ventricle in each minute which is circulated through the aorta in the whole body. So the blood which is circulated it must come to the heart at the same time which is known as venous return. Veins are our as we know veins are the capacitance vessel, that is 2/3 of the total blood is in the veins, so they hold more blood than arteries and but maintain the lower pressure. There are several factors which affect the venous return. Number one is right atrial pressure, mean systemic filling pressure, resistance to the venous return, thoracic pump, muscle pump, vasomotor tone, exercise, and gravity. We know the right atrium contains low pressure, that is 2 to 6 millimeters of mercury. So if there is increased right atrial pressure, it exerts a backward force on the veins, which disturb or impedes the flow of blood from the veins into the right atrium, ultimately decreases the venous return. The mean systemic filling pressure, if there is increased mean systemic filling pressure, which causes which forces the systemic blood towards the right atrium of the heart, as a result, venous return is increased. Resistance to the venous return. If there is increased resistance, increased venous return occurs. Resistance occurs between the peripheral vessels and the right atrium. If there is increased resistance to blood flow, what happens there? Increased accumulation of blood into the capacitance vessels, which ultimately decrease the venous return. Thoracic pump, which means during respiration, in case of inspiration, there is decreased intrathoracic pressure and increased intra-abdominal pressure. If there is increased intra-abdominal pressure, it increases the venous return to the right atrium. But simultaneously, the pulmonary veins become more capacious when lung expands, which retains some blood. So venous return is decreased in the left atrium. It means during inspiration, in the right atrium, venous return increases, and in the left atrium, venous return decreases. During expiration, the opposite thing occurs. What happens there? During expiration, there is increased intrathoracic pressure and decreased intra-abdominal pressure, which decreases venous return to the right atrium, but the lung squeezes or compresses and pulmonary veins become less capacious. So venous return to the left atrium is increased. When there is increased muscular activity, what happens there? Contraction of the skeletal muscle squeezes veins and capillaries. Squeezes the veins and capillaries, which propel the blood to the right atrium, and venous return increases. Vasomotor tone, sympathetic stimulation causes vasoconstriction, so as a result, venous return increases. During exercise, muscle contraction occurs, which squeezes the veins and increases the venous return. During gravitation, gravitational force has an important influencing factor during in case of venous return. In erect posture, venous return from the part of the body above the heart increases, but from the lower part of the body decreases due to gravitational force. This is all about the venous return. There is a Venna-Seton curve. Venna-Seton curve are the curves which demonstrate the relationship between the venous return and right atrial pressure. Venna-Seton curve also called systemic vascular functional curve. Normally 5 liters of blood returns to the heart in every minute. When right atrial pressure increases, venous return decreases due to back pressure because it exerts a backflow. When venous return decreases, the cardiac output also decreases. As we know, venous return and cardiac output is directly proportional. This is the venous return curve. Now, there are always these short terms comes in the written exam. What is the end systolic volume? What is the end diastolic volume? As we know, the end systolic volume, it is the volume of blood which remains in the ventricle at the end of the diastole. It means by diastole sheshe, systole means the contractile state of the heart and diastole means the relaxation state of the heart. যখন আমার ডায়াস্টোল কন্ট্রাকশন যখন হচ্ছে তখন ব্লাডটা ভেন্ট্রিকেলে আসছে, এট্রিয়া থেকে ভেন্ট্রিকেলে আসছে। দেন যখন ডায়াস্টোল হচ্ছে ব্লাডটা হোল ব্লাড তোমার অ্যাওর্টা দিয়ে হোল বডিতে ছড়িয়ে পড়তেছে। তাহলে হোয়াট হ্যাপেন্স দেয়ার ডিউরিং দা ইট ইজ দ্য ভলিউম অফ ব্লাড হুইচ রিমেইনস ইন দ্য ভেন্ট্রিকেল অ্যাট দ্য এন্ড অফ দ্য ভেন্ট্রিকুলার ডায়াস্টোল হুইচ ইজ অ্যাবাউট 110 to 120 ml, গ্যানোনে বলা আছে 130 ml। অল আর রাইট, there are several factors which is determining the end diastolic volume or the factors that influencing the end diastolic volume. Most important factor is filling time. Filling time is directly proportional to the end diastolic volume because when there is increased heart rate, decreased filling time, decreased end diastolic volume. Effective filling pressure. Effective filling pressure is directly proportional to the end diastolic volume. If it means when there is increased effective filling pressure, increased end diastolic volume. Now, what is effective filling pressure? It is the pressure gradient between inside and outside of the ventricle. It depends on two pressure, mainly intrathoracic pressure and intra-abdominal pressure. So, if there is any change in this pressure, the end diastolic volume will be changed. Increased pressure gradient, increased venous return, increased end diastolic volume. Then distensibility of the ventricles. Distensibility of the ventricles or it is the pumping ability of the ventricles. What happens there? In case of certain diseases like myocardial infarction, infiltrative disease or other abnormalities which causes the ventricular muscle become stiff or hard, which decreases the ventricular compliance. As a result, decreased ventricular filling, decreased end diastolic volume. And atrial contraction, if there is strong atrial contraction, strong end diastolic volume. Another short term is end systolic volume. It is the volume of blood which remains in each ventricle at the end of ventricular systole, which is about 40 to 50 ml. The factors determining the end systolic volume is the pressure against which the ventricle is pumping, that is atrial pressure or pressure load. Pressure load is mainly the pressure in the aorta. When there is increased pressure load, there is stroke volume decreases, but end systolic volume increases. And number two is the strength of myocardial fiber contraction, that is force of contraction. Increased force of contraction, increased stroke volume and decrease end systolic volume. It means end systolic volume is inversely proportional with the force of contraction. Now, stroke volume and afterload. It is the resistance against which heart pumps blood or load during the muscle contract. It means, I explain you, it is the force that the muscle must generate to each.